Torah Life Ministries, come out of the world. Messiah people, seek the truth.
Well, there are many topics discussed in the Bible today, but the most popular topic that's not discussed is evangelism. And I would say it's the most popular item in all of Scripture. If you look at one subject in all of Scripture, what people did the most, more than anything else, from the prophets to even the pagans, is they street evangelized. They went from town to town or person to person and told them about a type of God. And whether it be a pagan God or Yahweh, that's what was done more than anything else. And then when a Christian say, what would Yeshua do? Well, we look at what he did. He was the world's greatest street evangelizer. Or if they didn't have streets back then, whatever you want to call it. But for me, I didn't grow up a believer. I was an atheist growing up. And in New York City, I grew up, I used to see street preachers all the time. And I didn't think much of them, thought they were crazy people. And then when I became a believer, I still didn't agree with the approach of street evangelism. So when people come up to me now these days and tell me they don't agree, I can resonate with what they're saying. But I had an experience that changed it all for me. I'm going to share with you, and then we're going to talk a little about street preaching and maybe get into some of the notes here, or maybe I'll give you some scriptures. But have anyone here street evangelized before? Great, wonderful, okay. When is the last time you told somebody Yeshua died for you, for them? Let me say it again. When is the last time you told somebody Yeshua died for them?
About a week ago.
Okay, good. Most people can't answer that. Their answer is never. Most Christians, their answer is never. Or once in their life. And we need to be telling people this every single day. And the apologetics of the Bible, which so many people hold dear to and love to discuss, is something I don't rarely do when I'm street evangelizing. I want them to know somebody died for them. And later on we could discuss these topics of the apologetics of the Bible. But I'm not going to stand on a street corner and get in a conversation with an atheist or a Buddhist or even a Christian about apologetics. I am there to tell people he died for us. And nobody else in the world would die for us and has died for us. So we need to take this seriously. And then when you look at the consequences of what that means and why he died for us, we need to go out there and do what he called us to do and go out there and let people know that. You know, so I want to let as many people know as possible, because we are called to be health watchmen. You know, a lot of people talk about, well, we're the priest today. No, we're called to be the health watchman first. Well, not the health watchman, but watchman first. Ezekiel says we are to warn the people when something is about to happen. And if we do that, their blood is no longer on our hands, even if they reject it. But if we don't do that, we are just responsible as they are, and their blood is on our hands. So I'm making sure every single person that knows me knows that Yeshua died for us. And whatever they want to say, whatever they want to think, we can discuss that and talk about that and so on at another time. But it's our responsibility, believers, to let people know that. And so for me, the experience was, after I didn't like street evangelism, didn't think it worked, didn't think it was right, all the things I hear people saying about me now, and for those people that think it doesn't work, one of my favorite street evangelists on the internet, he has a great testimony when people come up to him and say, how do you know this works? He says, that's how I was saved. How can you argue with something like that? That's how it reached him. So it does work. And yes, there's different methods for everybody and different ways to do this. But street preaching alone doesn't mean standing on a corner and screaming. You know, handing people tracts, sitting next to somebody on a plane or whatever. There's many different forms of street evangelism. Just by the way you dress and act is a form of street evangelism, because you're making a statement and people are willing to discuss it or at least know something is different. That's what set apart is. We are to be set apart, and so people would recognize us. So my experience was, I was in New York City and I was people watching, and there was a street evangelist there. And this is already after I was a believer. This was years ago, I don't know. 6 or 7 years ago, maybe 5 to 7 years ago, something like this. And I was sitting there and watching this young kid street evangelize. And a lot of people were harassing him. and he just kept reading the scriptures. And then a man dressed as a woman came up to him. It wasn't Bruce Jenner. It was a man dressed as a woman and started yelling at him and screaming at him. Clearly, there was a demon in this man. And this fellow just kept to the scriptures. And for a half hour, this demon was there just yelling and screaming at him. And there were a lot of other people doing the same thing. And that's when it hit me and my eyes were opened. The demons cannot leave the presence of scripture. They might yell, they might scream, they might holler, but they're not leaving the presence of scripture. This man dressed as a woman, this shim or whatever you want to call it, got to hear the gospel for a half hour. Got to hear scripture for a half hour. I mean, if he didn't like what was being said, he could have cursed the guy out and walked away. He didn't have to stand there yelling for a half hour. So you know, that's it. We have to get scripture to people that would never ordinarily hear it. And these people definitely aren't going into a church to hear scripture, or they're not turning on the TV. So it works. So that's when I had this revelation that this is what I need to be doing. And this does work because people are hearing scripture. But then I ran into a problem because, you know, I use the name Yahweh and Yeshua. And very few people, including Christians, know what that is. And what was I going to do? Well, I first went out 2 years ago and I street evangelized. And it was okay. I have it on video. And I actually met somebody. Somebody started talking to me. He was a Messianic believer. And so I was kind of preaching to the choir. In this place I was, I didn't go preaching to the choir. And that's another reason why I think street evangelism is so special is we can come to a conference or we can go speak at a church. We're preaching to the choir. And chances are they're going to agree with you. Most of the time, people do not come to listen to you because they disagree. They come to you because they agree and they like your message. And I will submit that if you leave a lecture and you agree with everything that the teacher has said, you did not learn a thing, and that is the worst lecture you ever heard. Because you might leave there saying, that's the best lecture I ever heard. I agree with everything you said. No, that was the worst lecture because you didn't learn anything. It might have tickled your ears, but you didn't learn a thing. When you start saying, I didn't agree with what he said, I got to go look it up, or I got to show him, or I got to restudy this, then you're learning and you're growing. So if I'm going to go talk to a church or a conference or something and speak to people that already know and agree with the message, I'll do that, and I do that, but that's preaching to the choir. But I want to reach people that would not ordinarily have heard this message. The scriptures talk about go and preach to every creature. It doesn't say to those that agree with you. So you know you're successful when people are disagreeing, not when they're agreeing. So, you know, when people are intimidated by saying nobody's going to listen or anything else, that's great. That's exactly where you need to be. You don't need to be somewhere where they agree. You know, so we don't have much time, and you know, we gotta use it as wisely as possible. So the first time I went out, I was speaking to this lady, and it was okay, but I still came into this dilemma: what name do I use? And then I started going out, and I started just saying Yeshua, Jesus, in the name of Yeshua, Jesus. And then I refined it a bit, and I was praying about it, and I got the perfect thing I think to say, and I say, I'm here talking to you about Yeshua, the one you call Jesus. And that just opens up everything. Because with that, people are asking, well, you know, what do you mean? And it just opens up this question. Well, what do you mean when you say that? Yeshua, the one you call Jesus. And now I got a radio show on a Christian radio station. What do I say? I'm here to tell you about Yeshua, the one you call Jesus. And it covers all the bases when you look at this. So that's what I've been doing, and I go out and I do this, and people say, well, does it work, or what's your goal, and how many people you're reaching, and how many people have got saved today, and all this? I'm not there to count people and give altar calls. I'm there to tell people what the scriptures say, what Yeshua told us to tell them. And ultimately, my goal is to make disciples. That's my ultimate goal, but I'm not expecting to do that on the street corner in front of a whole bunch of drunk people. But when I give them a track and they wake up in the morning from their hangover and they see that track and they don't want to deal with that life anymore and they come to my home group or give me a call, well, then we can start the process of discipling them. So it's not about, you know, it's not easy to measure this way of how you can do, how do you know it's successful. But there was a street preacher one time many years ago preaching, and a fellow walked by and heard it and coming home from work, And he wasn't a believer. And a street preacher just said, go home and pray that, you know, our Creator will reveal himself to you and you'll know. And that fellow did. And he went on to write some pretty amazing books. His name was A.W. Tozer. Not the street preacher, the fellow that heard it. So we don't know where our words are reaching and what's going to be successful and not successful. But what we do know is this does work. And for people that say they don't agree with this approach, we don't have to ask people to agree with anything. My question is to people when they say something like that, I said, I understand, and that's fine. But did I say something that wasn't scriptural? Did I say something that was incorrect? As my brother or sister, please correct me if I did. But if your issue was with the way I said it or where I said it, let that be your issue. You know, don't make that my issue. And don't let it become your issue. So you know, not all of us are called to go on a street corner and be screaming and yelling. And I don't even scream and yell now because I don't want to scream and yell. I tried that the first couple of times, but now I use a microphone or a bullhorn or something. Somebody came up to me last week when I was preaching in Florida, and they said, you know, why do you got to use a bullhorn? You know, I was right next to a stage where they had loud music. I said, can you speak up? I can't hear you. And they said, why do you got to use a bullhorn? And then I thought, well, now I hear you, because I want you to hear me. That's why. If you don't want to use a bullhorn, let's go talk in front of a library, or if I'm street preaching in front of a library, I could whisper. But when I'm preaching, why don't you go up to the stage and ask the people playing the secular music why they need speakers and a microphone? You know, so it's not the bullhorn that's offending people or the microphone. What is offending people is the message that's coming out. And most people are lukewarm and they'll just walk by you and they can care less. But it's the demons that stop. That stop. And they want to come up against you and try to distract you. I have a team with me when I go out. The real fruit isn't me standing there preaching. That's just to get people's attention. It's the one-on-one team that hands out a track or starts talking to the people and gives them a number or gets a number. You know, and I tell people majority of the time, look, I understand you got some questions, you know, but I got people here that can help you answer those. I'm here to preach, not to get in conversations. I'm not going to let you distract me tonight or something like that. And there are cases if I go out alone or if I'm led to speak to them, I might stop and speak to them. But for the most part, no. And there's a lot of good examples on the internet today of street evangelism, and each person does it a different way. They all have a different style. Ray Comfort is probably the most popular one that does it. But the measuring success is not by the crowd you've gotten or how many people stopped and gave up their life to Yeshua. No, that's not the way to measure success. But there's so many different styles out there. And find one that resonates with you. But do something. You know, sometimes I talk to somebody, you know, maybe there's three of us, and when I leave, I say to my friend, you think that person was a believer? If you have to ask that question, or if somebody has to ask that question about you, you failed. Every single person should know what you believe in. Yeshua dying for us and told us to go and make disciples. Everyone should know that. No one should even doubt that. I'd much rather be called, a disciplined legalist for Yeshua, then you think that person was a believer? You know? And I take it as a compliment if somebody calls me a legalist, because I know I'm saved by Yeshua's blood, not by works, but I do the works because I am saved. You know? And if I come off as too strong, what a compliment. Well, I think you were too strong with that person, or you told them too much, or you were too passionate. Thank you. As opposed to, well, you know, everyone's going to love you. You should go open a mega church, you know, to just give them what they want to hear. No, we got to give them what they need to hear. And that starts with Yeshua died for them. And we need to tell people that, you know, that Yeshua died for them. Who's Yeshua? Well, he's our Savior who died for you. One of my greatest lines when I street preach is, you know, how many of you know somebody who would die for you? Well, I have. You know, his name's Yeshua. You know, because we got to think, if we were standing on a street corner and somebody pulled up to us, And got out of the car with a gun and put it to a head and was ready to fire it, and somebody pushed us out of the way at the last second and jumped in front of a bullet and took that down, I promise you, we would be on the news, we'd be on talk shows, we'd be everywhere telling people what that person did for us. Every single day with passion for the rest of our life, we'd be thankful for it. We wouldn't be intimidated not to tell people. But somebody did do that for us. Yeshua died for us and took a beating for us. You know, we should have that same passion to tell people every single day. I could stand on a street corner in a popular area and a lot of people's ears will hear it. Or I could stand on a street corner in a not so popular area and maybe a few people will hear it. But people are hearing it and we've done our part. And that's what we got to do. So we got to get the message out, and the scriptures confirm this. One of my favorite scriptures is Mark 16:15. Mark 16:15 says, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature." You know, there are more commands just than the commands of Torah. You know, this is what we're told to do. And this is what we're told to do, being a health watchman in the scriptures, or being a watchman in the scriptures. That's the example they set for us. You see, the prophets in scripture set an example of how we are to live and the consequences we're going to get, or the prophetic books. And it lays it out for us what we're going to get. And there are more of these, you know, but why is it not so popular today? Why is it so popular in the scriptures to street evangelize, but it's not popular today? The cops even come up and try to stop you from doing it. It's because most people today are controlled by the evil enemy, the adversary, and even the police, and even the world. The streets are flooded with sin. There's evidence of sin everywhere. And people don't want to hear the truth. The lukewarm, they're not concerned. You know, it's the opposition, and that includes many Christians. I have more Christians come up against me and curse me and yell at me and scream at me, tell me to leave, more than I do the New Agers that'll try anything once. It's amazing. It's really amazing. So, but why is it not so popular today? Three reasons. Number one, the enemy is against it. The enemy is against it. He doesn't want people to hear it. You know, he doesn't want people to know this. And the scriptures are an amazing light in this darkness of this world. And the enemy controls that darkness, and he doesn't want people to find that light. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, "Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Yeshua, who is the exact likeness of our wonderful Creator Yahweh." The enemy is against it. And everyone that's listening to the enemy, whether they know it or not, is against it. Why else isn't it not popular? Because the world's against it. Mark 13:13 says, "Everyone will hate you because of me, but the one who stands firm in the end will be saved." Everyone will hate you because of me. But we have to stand firm till the end. And then the church hates it. The church doesn't want this message to be out there. The church itself, you know, they have no problem with somebody sharing their testimony or something else. But the word repent, one of the most important words in all of Scripture, has become a curse word to the church today. You could tell people about your testimonial, but don't tell them to repent. We don't want to offend them. We don't want to scare them away. No, all throughout the Scriptures, repent was used before it said accept Yeshua. See, today the church teaches accept Yeshua and repent. But that's not a scriptural model. The scriptural model is repent and accept Yeshua. Amen. Over and over again. So if we got something backwards here, that's why it's not working. 2 Corinthians 11:4 says, "You have happily put up with whatever anyone tells you, even if they preach a different Messiah than the one we preach, or a different kind of spirit than the one you received, or a different kind of gospel than the one you believed." That's what the church does. They're just completely against this. And how has this affected us today? The average person, the average Christian, the average so-called believer has no problem going up to a stranger on the street and asking for directions how to get somewhere. But if you tell them to go tell somebody they've been saved, they have their tongue is tied. They get all nervous and shaky. And they don't want anything to do with that. That's how it's affected us today, all this. Yahweh says in Psalms 94:16, "Who will rise up against evildoers? Who will stand up for me against the workers of iniquity?" That's it. That's a question we need to answer the call. We need to answer the call. And the reason it needed to be asked, because there's not enough people doing it. We have to understand what the word preach means. The word preach means to raise the voice out loud. That's what it actually means. Proverbs 120 to 21 says, wisdom shouts in the streets. She lifts her voice in the square. And the head of the noisy streets, she cries out. At the entrance of the gates in the city, she utters her sayings. We understand this is what we are called to do. To go and tell others and share it with them. Not just once in your life. And when you do it, I guarantee if you think you want to feel a set apart spirit, you will feel it more than you ever have in your life. Every single person that's ever did it and the first time they spoke it out publicly, that Yeshua died for us, whether they would, or even if they were just handing out a tract to somebody, it was a feeling that comes over you that you can never ignore. It's the most addicting, amazing feeling ever. Who went out with us the other night? Anyone here? Do you agree?
Yeah.
I mean, amazing. It works, folks. It says in Luke 14:23, and the master said to the servant, go to the highways and the hedges and compel the people to come in, that my house be filled. We need to go and stand and speak. That's what we need to do. This works because we now have a chance to present the gospel to people who may never ever even step foot in a church or some place where it was being preached. 2 Timothy 4:2 says, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with complete patience and teaching. That's scripture. That's scripture. People might say, well, you're judging. You're sure right I'm judging, because that's what the scripture calls us to do. It says we are to judge righteously, to lift people up, not to lift them down. If I'm doing something that I shouldn't be doing, as my brother and sister and as a watchman for Yahweh, you are to come to me. You are to, in judgment, you are to judge me and to help me lift me up. There's only one judge on the final day, the judge of our salvation, and that's Yahweh, that's you, that's Yeshua. But we have to let people know now. And the only way we can let people know is without discernment. We don't know ourselves. We have to be able to discern. To discern, to know what right from wrong is. To compare it to the scriptures. And if somebody's doing something they shouldn't be doing, we need to tell them. And if they want to call it judging, if they want to call it being nosy, or, you know, call it what you want, but you're welcome. That's what we have to do. If I'm walking around here doing something I shouldn't be doing, if somebody's sitting down there eating a ham sandwich, if somebody you know is married over there with another girl, you're not going to walk by and say, well, I can't be a judge. I'm just going to love everybody. No, you got to tell them. That's wrong. If they don't listen, you come to them with another brother or sister. That's wrong. And if they don't listen, you stand with them in front of the door, you open up the door, and you kick them out the door. That's what the scriptures say. Remember what I said earlier. It's not what we want to hear. It's what we need to hear. It's what we need to hear. Well, people today, you know, they're not getting it. They're not getting it. They're not. Most of the churches, we don't like that approach. That's the church. 1 Chronicles 16:23. Sing to Yahweh all the earth. Proclaim the new from day to day of his salvation. The news. 1 Chronicles 16:23. Sing to Yahweh all the earth. Proclaim the good news from day to day, his salvation. I am not a singer. I don't sing. I don't have a good voice, but I have the greatest song and I sing it every time I'm out there. I say, you want to hear great music? How about this one? Yeshua died for you. Now go and repent. Hallelujah. The world's greatest song. Sing every day the news and go out there and let people know. So this is what we've been doing. One time a guy came up to me. He said he was a Mormon. He was drunk. He was a drunk Mormon. And I've learned not to even waste my time to talk to drunk people. I give them a card. When you're sober, contact me. I'll be happy to talk to you. But he was there talking to me, and I was talking to him. And he said to me, and this was, I was getting a little discouraged. Is this working? A lot of people listening. This is when I first started, and I record everything I do because that is my protection from the police, from the demons and everyone else with the camera there. I know if somebody tries to say something, I say, well, no, this is what was actually said. It helps tremendously. It's not for my glory, it's for my protection. So he says to me, he comes up to me and he says, "I've been listening." No, well, actually, he's arguing with me. And then when I later, I look back at the video, he said, "I've been listening to this garbage for an hour and I'm going to say something." Hallelujah, he got to listen to the gospel for a whole hour. It works. It works. So, you know, we need to go out there and do this. And again, there's different ways and different methods. But go and do it. Put tracks on some cars. You know, what drives me crazy, and I say, why? When I leave my house, my neighbor, I leave my house, and I'm driving down the block on a weekend, I see a whole bunch of teenage kids with a big sign that says car wash with an arrow to go in the car wash so they could wash their cars or whatever. If they could stand in a corner with a sign that says car wash, why can't we stand in a sign on the side that says, you know, sin wash or something? Come in this parking lot and we'll pray for you or something. Awesome. Free prayers or something. Why can't we do that? And if the police are allowed to come up to us and say, we can't be there, well, then why are they allowed there? We have to know our rights. We have to educate ourselves. We have to understand. You know, when the police come to us and say, well, you're not allowed to be here. Well, there's a public street. You know, or I know the ordinance. I know what's up. You're not allowed to use a microphone or a bullhorn. Well, you know, I study this. I understand what the ordinance is. I know if I'm not, I don't want to get in trouble with the police. But if they throw me in jail, I'll do what they did in the scripts. I'll preach in the jail. You know, so we're called to do this. We got to do this. And I promise you, it's really difficult to think about going out there and speaking in public, often about anything. But even if you're speaking in public in general, what I have found is, if you know your subject, there's no such thing as stage fright. Stage fright comes when you're not confident in your subject, for the most part. I was sitting in a dentist office once, or many times, but this particular time, the dentist was on one side and his assistant was on the other. And the assistant said to me, "I don't know how you can get there on stage and talk about eating healthy in front of all these people. I'd be so nervous." And the dentist said to her, "Yeah, but if you had to go and tell people about the Bible, you wouldn't be nervous because that's what you believe in." She goes, "I see your point." So we have to know our subject well enough, or at least believe in it strong enough, to not have that stage fright in front of people. But going out on the street, it's a little intimidating. But you know what? As soon, and this is what I read before I went, somebody said, as soon as you say that first sentence, it all goes away. It all goes away. And every single person that's ever come out with me, and I love to go to conferences and go to events, and people come street preach with me, and they just go and they hand out cards. But they say, "Well, I'd like to say something. I'm being moved to talk." And they say the same thing. Once you get that first sentence out of the way, there's no fear or anything. I think I actually have it on video. Well, the first two times I went, I have it on video. And it's exciting for me. I see how much I learned and stuff. But the first time I was yelling and screaming, I didn't have a microphone. Couldn't talk the next day. So then I got a cheaper microphone, and I was still yelling and screaming. But then finally, now I got a bullhorn, and I could talk, but my ears are a little bad. No, but it works. It works. And we just went out on Easter doing something different than I do, because usually I'm talking, but we were just out with signs. You know, we weren't talking. We were out with signs. The cars could stop, you know, basically just said, you know, it was on this. And I do have a sign. I also have a sign that I go out there with when I am speaking. I have a sign, a bullhorn, and a camera, and a shirt. So we come very prepared. But sometimes the police give us trouble. Sometimes they don't. And I just, on Easter, got kicked out of public property. No, it was private property, but they said I couldn't video. But everyone was videoing. And they said I couldn't. So I said, well, there's enough place to go. It's Easter. You know, so I don't want to spend my time arguing with police or even people. I'm not here to convince. I'm not here to persuade. And I'm not here to trick people into believing Yeshua died for us. I'm here to tell them, to proclaim, to give them the good news. What they do with that, if they don't want to believe it, if they come up against it, that is not my business. That's between them and our Creator. This is why I'm not a debater. You know, there are other people out there that love to debate. No. I'm going to tell you this, and I'm going to show you where to find it if you're interested. If somebody had a map in their hand that led to some treasure, and you told them that, and you were willing to give it to them, and they wanted to stand next to you arguing, saying, well, that really doesn't lead to treasure. You know, well, why don't you take the map and go look before you think that? And they say, no. Well, okay. Who else wants it? You don't got to stand there convincing them and debating them. As believers, we should never have to debate about Yeshua or about Scripture. It's Scripture. It says it right there. You know, I know there are some scriptures that might people can translate different or get a different idea. That's another story. But for somebody to say, I don't believe that's true. Why do we have to even, let me put it this way. You don't need to defend the truth. You don't need to think you have to defend reality or what's going on. You know, often people defend things that are lies. Or they try to cover up a lie. That's their defense. You know, but somebody else might think, well, what they believe is true. You know, but one of the enemy's tricks is to distract us. To distract us from going in and talking to people and telling people. To give us that fear of going to tell people. No, the scriptures talk about not having any fear. And then we could look at examples in scriptures. You know, people say, what would Yeshua do? He opened and preached. What about Ezra, Jeremiah, Ezekiel? What'd they do? They preached. They preached the world. People say to me, somebody said to me the other day, well, you know, I don't think the Bible example is to do this. If you take evangelism, especially street evangelism, out of the Bible, your Bible would be this big. Not even. So if somebody's going to say that this isn't the Bible a model to do, you can look at a renewed covenant. You have Yeshua, the greatest preacher of them all, but Paul and Peter, that's what they did. That was their life calling. And it should be ours. You know, I've had people come out with me with their 3 and 4 year old kids. I said, you sure you want to bring them? Absolutely. I went one time with a fellow and we got it on film. He had his 8 year old kid, I think. And we were going in front of some kind of strip shop or something. And I said, you sure you want to bring him? He goes, of course. No, you know, he said to me, well, you know what? I left it up to him and he wants to come. So we were out there on a bullhorn. The little kid was out there on a bullhorn. Repent, repent. And we got it on film. It was great. You know, so you know, this is what, and we have to understand, we have to be wise. We have to understand when it's time to just say, okay, I'm going to leave this situation here or something. But we also have to be bold. We have to be bold. You know, and with gentleness and love, I tell people, I'm out here because I love you. And people saying, well, you're not showing love. I say, no, if there's a building burning on fire and somebody's at the top of that building and they don't know there's smoke and fire at the bottom, what would be love? To start yelling and screaming and say, get out, or to walk by and not say a word? People don't get that. We have to understand, people are in great danger. Great danger. The flames are about to hit them. Some of them are within the flames. The most loving thing you can do is somehow get their attention to let them know the danger they're in. However you figure, but to walk by and do nothing is certainly not love. You know, that's the world's definition of love. Mind your own business. You know, Yeshua never told us that. Yeshua said to go and let people know about my business. You know, Yeshua said to let people know about me. Go out in the streets. Preach to every creature. Didn't say be selective. And that's what we do. We go out there and we tell everyone. We were out there the other night. I mean, you guys are here in Southern California. You know, one of my greatest principles of scripture is the harvest is few,
the harvest is ready, but
yeah, that one. but it's, you know, one of the problems I have where I live is there's one night that a lot of people come out to this particular spot where I can go out and preach, but for the most part, everyone's in their cars otherwise. People don't go out. They're in their air-conditioning cars to go to an air-conditioning building, and they don't want to go, but here, it's different. It's different here. You have people walking on the street. We went out Friday night. I mean, the street was packed. Packed. And people got to hear the gospel. And some people spoke to us. I mean, there were Muslims. There were lesbians, gay men, and just all over the place. All over the place. And sometimes they walk back more than once, and they got to hear it more than once. You know, and we gave out a tremendous amount of postcards. You know, so we have to reach others. We have to do that. Jeremiah is one of the greatest examples of all the scripture. And what did he do? He didn't look for the quiet little corner to preach. He says he was called to go to, and he did. He went to the gates of the city, which is where everyone congregated and where people had to come in and go out of the city. It wasn't like this. Back then, there was one entrance and one exit out of the gates. Example, on the Sabbath, they shut the gates, it says in, I think it was Ezekiel and a couple other books. They would shut the gates so people, the merchants couldn't come in on the Sabbath and stuff. That was it. That was the principle. It was the gate. So that was the most best spot. And he picked the best spot, and he was told to go to the best spot. You know, it says in Jeremiah 7:19, this is what Yahweh said to me. Go and stand in the gates of Jerusalem. First in the gate where the king goes in and out, and then in each of the other gates. The main gate, the smaller gates on the side. Go there and stand at the entrance to get the people going in and out. That's what he was told. Jeremiah 7:1-2 says, the word that came to Jeremiah from Yahweh saying, stand in the gate of Yahweh's house and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of Yahweh, all ye of Judah and that enter into the gates and worship our wonderful creator Yahweh. So he was going to the people, and he was going to the people that were living in hypocrisy. He was going into Judah, in Jerusalem. That's where he was. He wasn't even going to the heathen of the world. You know, Paul did that, and a lot of the apostles did that. Jeremiah and many of the other people in Scripture were going right in to the heart of the church. You know, that's one of the greatest places to preach the news about Yeshua and the gospel. It's to go right to the church. And some people say, well, if you're only going to preach the gospel, because I don't get into apologetics on the street, or that's not my goal, it's to preach the gospel. Well, Christians certainly know the gospel. You know, the part that says, if you love me, keep my commandments, that doesn't mean Christians love him because they don't keep his commandments. I don't agree with that. I think most Christians love him more than most people that keep the commandments. Because we might be desiring to keep the Sabbath and desiring to keep Passover and all this and say his name right, but they're willing to die for him. Last I checked, one of my favorite books I ever read, Fox's Books of Martyrs, there were people that died for him every day and they weren't keeping Torah. So they love him. It's just about the revelation of this and him opening up our eyes. Many are called, but few are chosen, and he will open up our eyes to see the greater gifts and blessings that come along with being obedient. But the point is, people might say, well, if they have the gospel in the church, they just don't have everything else, but they have the gospel in the church, why would you feel compelled to go to the church and teach that? Because it's a false gospel. It's a false gospel, what they're believing in. And it's a false Messiah, what many of them are believing in. Because they've been told something that's not true about him. So you can go there, you can go where you're led. I tell you what, you'll have more opposition from the police at a church than you would in front of a bar. Does something sound backwards about that? You go in front of a church and preach a Bible, and you'll have more opposition at the church than you would in front of a bar. It's just backwards. But you can go anywhere. I remember when I was going to come here, they said, we're going to go out at rush hour is when we're going to go out there because it was convenient for the schedule here. And I said, well, why don't we go afterwards? You know, do you know a place late at night to go? I said, yeah, but it's kind of wild and hectic and a lot of drunk people out and drugs out and all that. I said, that's exactly what we need to be. Exactly what we need to be. And we went out there. You know, and sometimes things happen. You got to learn. I was out in one city one time. And it's my goal, at least for now, is to go into every city in the United States, at least, if not the world. And one day the world, to go and preach the good news. But we were in a city in the Midwest. And there were two girls mocking us. And they started making out in front of us. And it was just, and then one of them tripped and they fell. And they both fell on the floor. And one of them hit their head. Yahweh knows what's going on. He sees what's going on. You know, people are going to get it one way or another. But what an amazing work that we could be, you know, give a track to somebody who's drunk, that they would put it in their pocket, and when they get home in the morning, they take off their clothes, pass out, and then they wake up in the morning, and before they're doing the laundry, they take that out of their pocket, and they see that. You know, we need to get the word of people. You know, we need to do that. And so that's what we could do. Now there's preaching, there's testifying, there's teaching and witnessing. And these all aren't necessarily the same things. And it's good to understand the difference. Witnessing is how you're going to interact with sinners on a daily basis. How you're going to interact with sinners on a daily basis, showing kindness and love to those that don't know Yeshua. Then you got testifying, is to testify, to acknowledge openly what Yeshua has done for you. So testifying. And then you got teaching. Teaching is giving the world, or giving the word to those who are saved and are being edified and matured by it. We're teaching them. You know, and then you have preaching. And what is done for the benefit of the lost when we are attempting to reach the God? What is done for the benefit of the lost whom we are attempting to reach with the gospel? That's preaching. We're trying to give it to the lost, to let them know. And we have to know as we were once lost as well. And I think about the story in scripture where the rich man set the other man free from his debt. And that man that was set free from his debt went to somebody else that owed him money and said, I'm still looking for my money. We've been giving the most amazing information. The most amazing thing in the world is the information about Yeshua that somebody at some point has shared with us. And for us not to tell others is doing the same thing that that man did. He was free, but then he went and tried to put somebody under him saying, I'm not going to tell you this information or give me my money. That's a great example of parable right there in scripture of why we need to do this. You know, I'm not going to tell you what you should be doing, but I'm telling you, you should right now be feeling the urgency to go out right there now on the street just to say, I got this done today, and I did this. There's a lot of people in this hotel right now walking around. They're definitely not modest. They have some cheerleading thing going on, and I see these people walking around half naked. There's a lot of people doing things they shouldn't be doing. I'm sure there's a lot of adultery and other things going on in this area that we don't know what's going on in people's lives, but we know what's happening. And we need to speak up. Maybe somebody will be convicted. So we need to go and let people know. What harm is it if somebody's, you know, in front of the hotel or walking around a lobby? You know, that's another, you know, a friend of mine staying with us now. And he goes, oh, I met this guy on a bench. What do you mean? The guy was sitting on a bench. So I sat next to him. And I just said, what is Messiah mean to you? And this guy has such a passion to go and teach, go to speak to the Jewish people. He's like, oh, I'm going to go tell the rabbis about Yeshua. And he comes home with another guy. He says, well, I met this guy on the bench and I was just talking to him. To go out and tell people. There's people sitting in a lobby right there. You know, to sit down next to them and talk to them. And, you know, we could reach people different ways. Women, you could reach women more than us men could. You know, and you can go sit next to one of those women that are wearing high heels and tight clothes and strike up a conversation and talk to them. And at least if anything, if they're not being receptive, say, you know what, you know, I got to get going, but let me just, can I give this to you and can you read it later? Just a track or something. At least to do something like that. You know, being on an airplane and flying for hours and hours, sitting next to a stranger and not saying anything about Yeshua, that's a crime. You have a perfect opportunity. You know, so what's stopping us from doing these things? What's keeping us from doing something like this? You know, so, you know, there's the extreme, but aren't we called to go to the extreme for him? You know, so to get people's attention, people ask me all the time or something. See, people used to think I was homeless until Duck Dynasty came out, so now they think I'm a movie star or something. First they used to call me they said, oh, there goes Yeshua or Jesus. And now they'll say, there goes Moses or something, because I'm getting longer and grayer. but it's getting to a point where people are actually saying something. I was stuck in Jamaica. I went to Jamaica and I was stuck, Kingston. I always was a little nervous about going to Kingston, Jamaica, but I always wanted to go to Kingston, Jamaica. I went to Kingston, Jamaica. People picked me up and I'm from New York City, and we got lost in the ghettos of Kingston, Jamaica. You know, and New York had nothing on this place. You know, and we were driving and looking around for a place to get where we got to be going and everything else. A whole bunch of people come up to the car. And they didn't look like they were just wanted to say hello and hear something from us. Until I rolled down my window and they saw me. And all of a sudden they started joking around with each other. Hey, there goes Moses and everything else. You know, and they gave us directions to where we had to be going. You know, so... And we gave them the word, you know. So you know, we time's running.
Yeah, 3 minutes.
Oh, what time is it in general anyway?
Well, you technically have until 1:45.
Yeah, what time is it?
It's 1:38.
Okay, good. So it's perfect timing anyway. So okay, so Matthew 3:2 says, "And saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." We need to tell people and let people know they need to repent. They need to repent. Repent is not a curse word. Repent is the most blessed word of all of Scripture that should be on the tip of our lips every single day. The more we can tell people, the better. And we judge in righteousness, with kindness and love. But the definition of love of Scripture, not of the world. And there are many examples in Scripture in the mid-1600s, 1700s, 1800s, some of, and Fox's Books of Mormon, people that are willing to lay down everything. To do what we're called to do. And this is what we're called to do. Whether you know it or not, we are called to share the news with others, the good news with others. That's what we're called to do, and that's what we need to be doing. So hallelujah, praise our wonderful Creator. And, you know, and I'll take a couple of questions, and I thank you for coming and just hearing about this. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, ma'am.
How would you tell someone that tell you that they have the old way and they don't want to let go of the old way, and it's your husband and he tells you you can go which way, or we should discuss and go to the same way? So,
well, that's a very good question, and I could say that being a preacher or an evangelist, or sharing, or street preaching, you know, in our house is a little different than doing it out of our house. Because if we tell somebody something on the street and they hear it, great. If they don't, they walk by. With the family, it's a little bit different. And about how we should approach that, you know, it's a prayer. It would be my number one thing, because I haven't been able to figure it out myself, you know, and prayer, you know, it's amazing. I can go in the world and tell thousands of strangers about Yeshua, and I'm not there to convince them to listen or not, you know, and I do believe we don't open anyone's eyes. Yahweh opens their eyes, and, you know, but sometimes in our own houses, it becomes more of a difficult challenge, and... But, you know, we're up for the call. We're up for the task. And the best thing we can do, in my opinion, as believers, is to stick to living righteously at all costs. And our actions speak a lot louder than our words. And so stick to righteousness. You know, if somebody tells me I can't keep the Shabbat, you know, I'm going to keep the Shabbat, not because I'm trying to prove them wrong, but because this is what Yahweh says to do. And the demons don't like that. And there are demons and spirits out there that shudder at righteousness, you know. But words are another story, you know. Our words mean nothing if our actions don't follow. Yeah.
Come out of the world, oh my people, seek the truth, avoid the evil, learn Yahweh's ways, Torah life, men astray, come out of the world, oh.